Hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn. Hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn is the destruction of red blood cells of a fetus and or neonate by antibodies produced by the mother. In the past, about 95% of the cases of hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn were caused by antibodies in the mother directed against the D antigen. The incidence of hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn caused by anti-D has steadily decreased since 1968 with the introduction of Rh immune globulin, or what some people called Rogam, because this is one of the manufacturer's names. The HDFN caused by antigens other than D are more common now. So what is the etiology of HDFN? The red cells of the fetus are destroyed by antibodies produced by the mother's immune system. Only the IgG class antibodies are actively transported across the placenta. If the child's cells inherit the antigen from their father that the antibody is directed against, then the baby will develop HDFN. The firstborn child is usually not affected because the mother has not been immunized against the father's antigens. But during gestation and delivery, when the placenta separates from the uterus, fetal cells may mix with maternal circulation. If the D antigen is inherited from the father, these fetal cells immunize the mother and stimulate the production of anti-D. Once the mother is immunized to the D antigen, all subsequent offspring who inherit the D antigen will be affected. The maternal anti-D crosses the placenta and binds to the fetal red blood cells. So how does antigenic exposure occur? The transplacental hemorrhage of fetal cells into maternal circulation occurs in up to 7% of women during gestation. At delivery, this occurs in 50% of women. Interventions such as amniocentesis and chorionic villus sampling, as well as trauma to the abdomen, may cause the increased risk of fetal maternal hemorrhage. Host factors that affect the ability of individuals to produce antibodies in response to antigenic exposure varies, depending on complex genetic factors. Of the four subclasses of IgG antibody, IgG1 and IgG3 are more efficient in red cell hemolysis than IgG2 and IgG4. This will affect the severity of the hemolytic disease. Of all of the red blood cell antigens, D is the most antigenic. Of the non-Rh system antibodies, anti-KEL, or anti-big K, is considered the most clinically significant in its ability to cause hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn. The ABO group of the mother and the child can affect the development of HDFN. It is better for the fetus to have a major ABO incompatibility. The mother will remove the ABO incompatible cells due to their ABO antigens and will not notice a D antigen. Hemolysis occurs when maternal IgG attaches to specific antigens on the fetal red blood cells. The rate of fetal red blood cell destruction depends on the antibody titer specificity and the number of red blood cell antigenic sites. Fetal red cell destruction and the resulting anemia stimulates the fetal bone marrow to produce red blood cells at an accelerated rate. The immature fetal blood cells, or erythroblasts, are released into the circulation, which is called erythroblastosis fetalis. Hepatosplenomegaly may result from extramedullary hematopoiesis. Severe anemia and hyponatremia lead to development of high output cardiac failure with generalized edema, effusions, and ascites, a condition known as hydrops fetalis. The rate of red cell destruction after birth decreases because no additional maternal antibodies are entering the infant's circulation through the placenta. The red blood cell destruction releases hemoglobin, which is metabolized to bilirubin. The maternal liver can metabolize the unconjugated bilirubin during pregnancy, but after birth, the immature newborn's liver cannot adequately process the unconjugated bilirubin. Remember that unconjugated bilirubin is the bilirubin that is the problem for the infant. With moderate to severe hemolysis, The unconjugated or indirect bilirubin can reach toxic levels in the infant's brain if it reaches more than 18 milligrams per deciliter. If untreated, it can cause kernicterus or brain damage. When a woman is pregnant, the prenatal testing includes a blood type and an antibody screen. The physician will need to know if the patient has previous pregnancies or transfusion that can indicate antibody production to red blood cells. The antibody screen is designed to detect clinically significant IgG alloantibodies that are reactive at 37 Celsius and in the antiglobulin phase of testing. Early detection of antibodies means the physician can closely monitor the infant for indications of hemolytic disease of the fetus. If the antibody screen is positive, the antibody ID must be determined. The follow-up testing will depend on the antibody specificity and likely clinical significance. Many Rh-negative women are weakly reactive anti-D, particularly in the third trimester, due to injection of the Rh immune globulin in the 28th week of pregnancy. This is a passive anti-D and not one produced by the woman. The passively administered anti-D will be weakly reactive in testing and will remain positive for 2 months or longer. This will distinguish the active immunization from RHIG. Other than anti-D, the most common and most clinically significant antibodies are anti-big K, anti-D, anti-little C, anti-big C, and anti-Duffy A. If the mother has anti-D and the father is D positive, a complete Rh phenotype can help determine the chance of being homozygous or heterozygous for the D antigen. This can tell you what the chance of the infant inheriting the D antigen. But since the identity of the father is not always certain, it is better to do genetic testing or a genotype of the fetus. If the fetus does not have the antigen, then the antibody cannot cause hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn. For DNA testing, the sample is done by amniocentesis or chorionic villus sampling, can be performed as early as 10 to 12 weeks gestation to determine if the fetus has the gene for the antigens that the mother has made antibodies to. A complete genotype can be performed. An antibody titer is performed on antibodies that are IgG. This tells us if the amount of antibody is increasing. This method includes the indirect antiglobulin phase using anti-IgG reagents. The titer score will be reported in a standard method to allow comparison. The titration must be performed exactly the same way each time so that comparison is valid. A titer of 16 is considered the critical titer. If the initial titer is 16 or higher, the titer should be repeated at 18 to 20 weeks gestation. A titer that is above 32 and repeats above 32 represents an indication for color Doppler middle cerebral artery peak systolic velocity study, which is performed by the radiology department to determine the presence of fetal anemia. If a titer is below 32, it should be repeated at 4 weeks intervals, beginning at 16 to 20 weeks gestation, then every 2 to 4 weeks during the third trimester. The titer does not always predict the severity of hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn, but if the titer is below the critical level, this reliably predicts an unaffected or mild to moderately affected infant, with the exception of anti-big K with a big K positive infant. The color Doppler middle cerebral arterial peak systolic velocity is performed on patients with a history of severely affected fetus or early fetal death to allow for early intervention. This procedure reliably predicts anemia in the fetus. The amniocentesis is a more invasive procedure and is not utilized if the Cutler Doppler middle cerebral arterial peak systolic velocity procedure can give us the information that we need. The concentration of bilirubin pigment in the amniotic fluid measured at 450 nanometers can predict worsening of the fetal hemolytic disease. Intervention in the form of intrauterine transfusion becomes necessary when one or more of the following conditions exist. The MCA-PSV indicates anemia. Fetal hydrops is noted on ultrasound examination. Fetal hemoglobin level is less than 10 grams per deciliter, or amniotic fluid reading of 450 nanometer results are high. The risk and benefits of intrauterine transfusion must be weighed and evaluated by the provider. An infant who develops hyperbilirubinemia of unconjugated bilirubin after delivery can be treated with phototherapy. The phototherapy at 460 to 490 nanometers is used to change the unconjugated bilirubin to isomers, which are less lipophilic and less toxic to the brain. If a bilirubin reaches 18 to 20 milligrams per deciliter and is not treated, an infant can develop kernicterus or permanent damage to parts of the brain. Intravenous immune globulin is increasingly used to treat hyperbilirubinemia of the newborn caused by HDFN. The IVIG competes with the mother's antibodies for the Fc receptor on the macrophages in the infant's spleen, reducing the amount of hemolysis. So the infant's red blood cells would be coated with antibody, but the spleen would not destroy them. An exchange transfusion is when whole blood or an equivalent is used to replace the neonate circulating blood. This is primarily used to remove the high levels of unconjugated bilirubin. This is used in more severe cases when phototherapy will not be effective. Some other advantages are that this removes part of the circulating maternal antibody, removes sensitized red blood cells, and replacement of incompatible red blood cells with compatible red blood cells. The donor unit would be negative for the antigen the mother has made an antibody to. The cord blood sample can be used to confirm HDFN and prepare for possible transfusion. The ABO grouping, RH, and DAT and elution testing are performed. The elution can remove the antibody and allow you to do an antibody ID. The antibody should match the ID performed on the mother sample. Most centers treating HDFN use group O red blood cells for intrauterine and neonatal transfusions. The red blood cells must be antigen negative for the respective antibodies of the mother. The donor should be CMV negative and the unit should be less than 7 days old. These units are also usually negative for sickle cell disease or trait. RHIG is a prophylactic treatment designed to prevent hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn due to anti-D in RH negative mothers. The idea is to stop the mother from making anti-D. If an RH negative mother has an RH positive infant, the mother has a 16% chance of being stimulated to form anti-D. Although the exact mechanism of action is uncertain for RHIG, it is thought that by giving the RHIG, which is a passive form of anti-D, it will coat any fetal cells in the mother, and the mother's spleen will remove them from circulation before the immune system recognizes them as something to create an antibody to. Evidence indicates that RHIG interferes with B-cell priming to make anti-D. The important point is that this is highly effective and allows RH-negative mothers to have multiple RH-positive babies without making anti-D or having an infant with hemolytic disease of the fetus and newborn. The RH-negative non-immunized mother should receive RHIG within 72 hours after delivery of an RH-positive infant. If an RH-negative mother delivers an RH-negative infant, then they are not given a dose of RH immune globulin after delivery. The blood bank is involved in determining the dose of RHIG. One dose of RHIG in the United States has sufficient anti-D to protect against 30 milliliters of whole blood. A fetal screen is performed first. If negative, then one dose of RHIG is given. If positive, then the Kleihauer-Betke test is used to determine the volume of fetal hemorrhage, or flow cytometry can also be used. So if the fetal screen is negative, then we give one dose of RHIG. If it is positive, then we have to do a semi-quantitative Kleihauer-Betke test to determine the volume of fetal bleed. 2,000 cells are counted, and the cells that are not ghost cells are the fetal cells. The percentage of fetal cells is determined. Then we multiply that result by the maternal blood volume of 5,000 milliliters to determine the volume of fetal bleed. Then we divide by 30 to get the number of doses. Once we have the number, we will perform rounding up or down. If the decimal is 0 to 4, we round down and then add 1. If the decimal is 0.5 to 0.9, then we round up and add 1. This is the number of doses to issue to the patient once you've added 1. RHIG is of no benefit once a person has actively immunized and has developed anti-D, and RHIG is not given if the infant is also D negative. ABO, hemolytic disease of the fetus, a newborn, is also limited to type A or B infants of group O mothers and can occur in the first pregnancy. When it is determined that a mother is group O, the blood type and DAT are performed on the cord blood sample after delivery. The antibody screen is not helpful in diagnosing this issue. This is now the most common but least severe form of HDFN due to the implementation of RHIG and the prevention of anti-D-associated HDFN. Phototherapy is usually sufficient to treat infants that develop jaundice 12 to 48 hours after delivery. Thank you for listening.